Welcome to another edition of Horse Center, everyone. I am Brian Zipsy, and as always, I have the excellent pleasure of being joined by my co-host to the East Coast. That's Matt Schiffman. How are you today, Matt?
I am good, Brian. I don't know. I've been paging through my calendar, and it looks like 1 month till the Breeders' Cup.
Yeah, 1 month to the Breeders' Cup, Matt. But we're also kind of looking forward to what's going to happen next year with this show. This is going to be our two-year-old, our big pre-Breeders' Cup two-year-old show, folks. And I think we start talking about these horses as Kentucky Derby and Kentucky Oaks candidates too, Matt, which is always exciting, the long lead up to those big races. But last year, you know, it's really nice to see those Breeders' Cup juvenile horses. This has not been the case in a lot of years, but the Breeders' Cup juvenile horses from last year, like Essential Quality and Hot Rod Charlie and Jackie's Warrior, even Keep Me in Mind, have come back to be really, really good three-year-olds. So that's nice to see. I kind of hope that trend continues, Matt, because when we were younger, man, that was kind of the rule where the good two-year-olds would come back and be really good at three.
Yeah, I would love for that trend to continue, Brian, but I don't know. We'll have to see about that.
We'll have to see. But folks, right now we're talking Breeders' Cup Juvenile, Breeders' Cup Juvenile Fillies. Matt, I think we're going to start with the boys today, Kentucky Derby candidates, all of them. But of course, even more so right now, as you said, 1 month away from the Breeders' Cup Juvenile, mile 16th, $2 million. This year, it's Friday, November 5 at Del Mar. I want to start in your neck of the woods with Jack Christopher. The son of Monning's chained by Chad Brown has been awfully good in two starts, Matt.
Sure has. In the Champagne, it was a matchup between horses with experience. About half the field were more experienced horses with three, four, five starts. And then the rest of the field were horses that had only run once. And as it turned out, Brian, those were the ones, the less experienced horses that kind of dominated the Champagne.
Yeah, they did, Matt. Witt and Gunite, the horses coming out of stakes races at Saratoga, first and second in the hopeful, really offered little resistance. Gunite was out there early. Witt never really got in. I guess he plodded up along the inside for third. But Jack Christopher was pretty darn dominant in this race. He was the one that went after Gunite as those two separated himself. And like I said, Matt, Jack Christopher put him away quickly. A good-looking son of Munnings. He had an impressive sprint maiden, one off for fun at Saratoga as his only race, as you said, for the Champagne. This was, of course, the one-turn mile at Belmont Park. It's yet to be seen if Jack Christopher is a true two-turn horse. But after these two races, you'd have to say that the talent there is pretty big.
Yes, lots of talent. And speed figures came back almost identical between the two races, between his maiden special weight win at Saratoga and between the victory in the Champagne. I like to see that neither one of those races appeared to be a fluke. After the race, Chad Brown says off to the Breeders' Cup, but I think in his mind, he has the same questions that we do, Brian, going two turns, heading out to California, et cetera.
Yeah, that's been a stumbling block for a lot of Eastern horses as they go out to a California Breeders' Cup. Some have made it. Good Magic certainly was able to do it a few years ago, but Jack Christopher will have to prove himself a little bit as he tries two turns for the first time and, of course, the long trip out west. He's got a really nice turn of foot. He's taking these races over at the head of the stretch, and he just looks like a really talented horse in good hands in Chad Brown. He should be well backed in the Breeders' Cup Juvenile, Matt, but I don't know that he's the favorite. There is a California horse with a similar resume, although he was actually a $1.5 million two-year-old in training purchase, trained by the familiar man, Bob Baffert. This son of Quality Road I'm speaking of is Corniche, and he looked good. He looked good going two turns, though, in Saturday's American Pharoah.
Yeah, and hey, his maiden victory, Brian, was a corker, recording the highest buyer speed figure, a 98, for any two-year-old this year. So he came out blazing, which, you know, is not anything new with some of these expensive Baffert 2-year-olds.
Yeah, and he shows a lot of speed, Matt. I think we are going to see more speed. We're projecting, of course, here a month out, but looking at the top list of candidates, we should see more speed. You mentioned the maiden win. It did come at Del Mar, so he's got to win, much like Jack Christopher, two different tracks, but he's got to win over the Del Mar main track, which means a lot this year for the Breeders' Cup. And then he stretched out nicely to a mile 16th. I think horses behind him may not have had the trip as he went right to the lead and kind of dominated early. He looked pretty good, though, coming down the stretch. Much like Jack Christopher, though, I think there are questions whether he's a true 10 furlong horse. Of course, we're only talking a mile 16th for the Breeders' Cup Juvenile, but I think there could be both distance limitations for each of these horses. Sometimes talent prevails and they outrun their distance limitations, but there should be some more speed for Caniche to deal with, but certainly impressive wins in both that 5.5 maiden race, 5.5 furlongs, and then a mile 16th in the American Farrah. The next horse on the list, Matt, is also trained by Bob Baffert. It looks like the controversy hasn't slowed down the 2-year-olds. He's won these races, the Del Mar Futurity, and now the American Farrah, oodles and oodles, bundles of times over the years, Matt. This year, no different. And we're talking about another horse, Matt, who is 2-for-2, Pinehurst, a son of Twirling Candy.
Yes, this was another one of those winners that Bob Baffert has had in the Del Mar Futurity. And like you alluded to before, it becomes even more important this year with that being the host of the Breeders' Cup. Certainly has not put up the kind of dazzling speed figures that Jack Christopher or Corniche put up in their early races.
Yeah, and I wonder about those speed figures just a little bit, because Pinehurst sure looked fast early. He's won both of his starts at Del Mar, a nice maiden win at Del Mar, and then the Del Mar Futurity, and he looked good to me winning the Del Mar Futurity. Now, he's never been farther than the 7 furlongs of that Del Mar Futurity, so he'll have to stretch it out here to 8.5 furlongs for the Breeders' Cup Juvenile. But, you know, of the three, I do see a little bit more pedigree for going 2 turns. He's got some Giant's Causeway on the bottom side, Matt, which always means distance to me. So Pinehurst, another very interesting horse for Bob Baffert. And frankly, I thought he beat a similar field as Corniche beat when he did it at Del Mar in the Del Mar Futurity. Corniche did it at Santa Anita in the American Farrah. Matt, let's just keep streaking along with these 2-for-2 horses. It's a different world these days with the Breeders' Cup Juvenile races, Matt, because two races for these horses has become the norm. I want to mention Major General, and I don't think that he's going to get the hype, certainly of the top two, maybe even the top three off of his 2 wins, because they were hard fought. But the son of Constitution, trained by Todd Pletcher, showed some grit and determinations in both of his wins.
Yeah, and that's a characteristic of Pletcher's horses. They get in a battle down the stretch, and more times than not, they come out on top. And, you know, at the lead-in to the show, you talked about Kentucky Derby, and you talked about the Breeders' Cup. Well, Major General won his stakes debut in the Iroquois at Churchill Downs, and that was a race that was not only a win and you're in to the Breeders' Cup, but it was also the first Derby point qualifying race. So here's a Pletcher that got double bounty with his victory in the Iroquois.
A double bounty, yeah, and we expect him to go out to Del Mar. Pletcher has a couple of horses on this list, like Baffert does, as per usual, I guess. Todd Pletcher being one of the top trainers in the country now, going on 2 decades, Matt. Major General, like Pinehurst, maybe a little bit more potential to go long. He's got that win over Churchill Downs that you mentioned, and he's had the work to do it. Certainly not as flashy as the top two, but certainly a horse I can't throw out as a major, no pun intended, major contender for the Breeders' Cup Juvenile. Let's start talking about horses that have actually lost a race, Matt, because usually the Breeders' Cup Juvenile is won by a horse who's lost a race. Not always, not last year. Command Performance, in fact, has not won a race, Matt. The son of Union Rags, also trained by Todd Pletcher, Tell me that a maiden can win the Breeders' Cup Juvenile.
Hey, I don't know, Brian, but, you know, it was really interesting to see Pletcher make a move like that. Certainly not typical for him to bring Command Performance back after a second in his debut. It was a late running second to go into, a pretty good field in the Champagne, where once again, he beat some experienced horses that we mentioned and some other talented, lightly raced horses to get second in the Champagne. So he'll go into the Breeders' Cup still as a maiden, and that's not unprecedented.
That's not unprecedented, Matt. I thought I was setting you up for a good magic spike here, because we did have a horse win the Breeders' Cup Juvenile as a maiden just a few years ago. Command Performance, I really like his two races quite a bit. The maiden at Saratoga, where he rallied for second that you mentioned, he really got off to an ugly kind of start in the race. So the fact that he was able to rally up to behind a nice looking winner to be second in that race, I think Pletcher deserved to be pretty confident of that performance, even though he didn't win it. And then I'll say the same thing about the Champagne. If you look late, Command Performance is really the horse running. And as Jack Christopher kind of cruises to the wire, Command Performance is picking up distance on Jack Christopher in that one turn mile. And if you look at the gallop out, Command Performance kept on going. He looks like a horse who will welcome his first time around two turns. He's also a horse, Matt, who might even welcome an even stronger pace. The Champagne was not a weak pace by any means, but two turns out at Del Mar with an even stronger pace, Command Performance improving. He's a horse to look out for as a maiden, but again, like all the others we've mentioned above him, only two lifetime starts. Now, Papa Cap is the son of Gunrunner, Gunrunner is just proving to be an absolute wonderful first-time sire this year, Matt. But Papa Cap is a horse that's interesting to me. He's going to be a long shot in the Breeders' Cup Juvenile. He won his first two starts, which was a maiden race at Gulfstream Park and then a graded stakes at Del Mar, the best pal. And then I really didn't like the trips he got in his next two. In the Del Mar Futurity, he was kind of down on the inside. He was being held, and he never looked comfortable. And he was in the photo for second, but he finished fourth. So it was not a particularly great Del Mar Futurity, but he looked uncomfortable. And then in the American Pharoah, first time around two turns, he was wide the whole way as he's trying to chase the speed of Corniche. I don't think that's necessarily a recipe for winning. So Papa Cap is a long shot who interests me as a son of Gunrunner.
Yeah, and he's trained by Mark Cassie, who took a while to get his first Breeders' Cup victory. But since he has done that, he's won a whole bunch of races in the World Championships. And one thing that we can always say about Cassie runners, they will come into their races, particularly these young ones, with more experience than a lot of others.
Yeah, I think that's a great point on both of those points, Matt. Cassie knows how to win Breeders' Cup races. And this horse, we just talked about five horses above him who've only had two races. Papa Cap has had four. And as I talked about, I think he's had some things to overcome in the last two. He didn't do it for the win. But on the other hand, he didn't run poorly in either. If he gets a better trip, maybe sits in fourth or fifth, he's an interesting horse to me. As is the next horse on the list, also coming out of the American Pharoah, Matt. His name is Oviatt Class. And Oviatt Class, if you watched the first seven furlongs or so of the American Pharoah and then left the room, you never really saw Oviatt Class. But he came running once again. It took him three races to break his maiden for trainer Keith DeSormo. But he rallied big to win his third race out. And then he rallied pretty big in here to be third in the American Pharoah.
Hey, he's a son of Bernardini, and that's a good thing going two turns. Interestingly, he's Virginia bred, and every once in a while, Keith DeSormo shows up on the Derby trail in the Breeders' Cup with, less ballyhooed horse than others and does some good things.
Yeah. We remember just a few years ago, DeSormo had a good 2-year-old and 3-year-old. This one might be the same as we're looking forward. Maybe this is another horse who could be a classic horse. I really like the way he finished the last two races. He was detached from the field in the American Pharoah. He was never going to win it, but he was making up a lot of ground the entire stretch at Santa Anita. His big win in that maiden race came at Del Mar against a pretty good maiden field. So another long shot that I find very interesting. The last horse I want to mention, Matt, needs to do more, but that more will come this weekend at Keeneland, because Classic Causeway, off of only one race, is entered for Brian Lynch, will be entered for Brian Lynch in the Grade One Breeders' Futurity at Keeneland this weekend.
Yeah, but that one race, Brian, he sure came out running at Saratoga, making his debut in a 7-furlong race that got a really nice speed figure, final time of 1:22 and change. That's a pretty nice debut for a 2-year-old.
Yeah, absolutely. Off that maiden win, I'm excited to see what he can do at Keeneland. He looks like a horse with a big potential, Matt, as well. Only one race in, but I expect good things here at Keeneland this weekend. And he's a son of Giants Causeway. So looking forward, he should be good to go around two turns, and he'll get that two turns this weekend at Keeneland. All right, Matt, we talked about 8 horses. I think we talked about the favorites for the Breeders' Cup Juvenile in a month. And we talked about some of the most interesting contenders below them. Early favorite on the list for you?
Hey, Brian, I think that Echo Zulu in this Philly division is certainly going to be a big, big favorite.
Okay, so she's your favorite. And you know what, Matt? I think she could potentially be the favorite in either race. She's going to run in the Breeders' Cup Juvenile Fillies, obviously, but she's been so good that I could actually see her, if this was just one race we're talking about, being the favorite over the boys. That's how good the daughter of Gunrunner has been for trainer Steve Asmussen, Matt. We saw it at Saratoga. She's now a 2-time Grade One winner after what she did on Sunday in the Frisette at Belmont Park.
Yeah, how unusual is that, Brian, these days, to say that heading into the Breeders' Cup for one of the juvenile races, we've got a 2-time Grade One winner. One of them at Saratoga in the Frisette, and then in the Spinaway, 3-for-3, fast races in both of them, a fast horse. I find her interesting because she sort of has the feeling to me as one that might turn out to be a sprinter, you know, kind of like Jackie's Warrior, but, another gun runner, and hey, gun runner went long.
Yeah, gun runner was able to develop, and he was a 2-turn horse pretty early in his career, but he certainly went long as he got more mature. And of course, he won the Breeders' Cup Classic at 1.25. Echo Zulu is very interesting. I have kind of the same thoughts. She just dominates with her speed, but then you see kind of that push button at the top of the stretch fly away, accelerate away from the other horses. And that's kind of the way Rachel Alexandra or Songbird did it in recent history, Matt. So Echo Zulu could really be any type. I like her pedigree. I like both sides of her pedigree. She's got some talent on her female side as well. And she's got some distance potential on both sides of that pedigree. So Echo Zulu, big maiden win, big win in the Spinaway, big win in the Frisette. She's never been 2 turns. She's never been to the West Coast. She's got some of the same questions that Jack Christopher, Corniche have, especially the, can she carry her speed around 2 turns against a really tough field? But right now she looks head and shoulders above this field. Echo Zulu promises to be, even coming from the East Coast, a heavy favorite in the Breeders' Cup Juvenile Fillies. I think a couple others though deserve strong mention. The first one I'm gonna mention is Ain't Easy. And she's actually trained by Phil D'Amato, Matt. A nice maiden win at Del Mar for the daughter of Into Mischief. She was liked in the Chandelier, the Grade Two Chandelier that was run on Friday out at Santa Anita. But she wasn't an overwhelming favorite or anything, but she made it look pretty easy.
She sure did, Brian. As you mentioned, Phil D'Amato, you know, not the big name that Bob Baffert is, but a trainer who is very good with young horses. And Joel Rosario was out west to ride Ain't Easy. And like you said, Brian, ended up winning the Chandelier impressively by almost five lengths.
Yeah, and she beat some pretty highly regarded fillies in there. Now, another thing I like her is that she does not need the lead. She took over pretty quickly in this two-turn Chandelier, but she's content to sit off the lead. She did it in both of her starts. Ain't Easy looks like a potentially very good horse, two for two, and a grade two winner already, but the shadow of Echo Zulu kind of looms over this field. But another a big two for two filly is Hidden Connection, Matt, and she's really interesting. Brett Calhoun's had some good horses of late. This looks to be another one. She's also from a first-time sire, and she started her career in Virginia.
Yeah, Brian, interesting horse. And another interesting thing about Hidden Connection is that she went to the auction ring four times, Brian, a variety of places, and ended up selling as a two-year-old the last time for $85,000. So not a high-priced auction price. And as you said, that may be why she started her career in Virginia.
Yeah, she started at Colonial Downs. Usually we think of turf at Colonial Downs, but she started on the dirt there at Colonial Downs. And off of that race, I wasn't sure how they were going to bet her in the grade three Pocahontas a few weeks ago. But the secret was out because they pounded her at the window. She was a clear favorite in the Pocahontas, and she made it look easy. I mentioned her first time sire. That's Connect. Connect was a really talented horse for Chad Brown years ago, actually beat Gun Runner in a very interesting edition of the Pennsylvania Derby years ago, Matt. Hidden Connection looked the type of possibly a special filly the way she won the Pocahontas. She was more impressive certainly than the males. The male race was won by Major General, Iroquois. The Pocahontas was the more impressive race. And she could be any kind too. It's just a different route she's taking than the normal New York California route. I should mention, because I mentioned Hidden Connection was more impressive in the Pocahontas than anything we saw in the Iroquois, but Echo Zulu, when she won the Frisette on Sunday, the day after, so it's a little different track, but she ran, I believe it was more than 2 seconds or a full 2 seconds faster than Jack Christopher did the day before in winning the Champagne, which only adds to the Echo Zulu hype machine, I guess. All right, Matt, I think those are the three obvious favorites for the BC Juvenile Fillies. And unlike the Breeders' Cup Juvenile, I have a little harder handle of figuring out who exactly will be in this race. Averly Jane probably, I'm thinking, is not going to run in this race, but she is definitely one of the more interesting two-year-old fillies in the country, trained by Wesley Ward, daughter of midshipman, because she has looked so good in her three career starts so far.
Yeah, and when you say two-year-old by Wesley Ward, then you know that you have to be talking about a horse that started her career a little bit earlier on, and a two-year-old that is very fast, and that's Averly Jane, who is three for three already with three wins at three different tracks. Ward brought her out early at Keeneland, then she won at Churchill Downs, and then she went to Saratoga and won the Skidmore Stakes, blazing fraction, Brian, for a juvenile in that race, 21 and change and 57. So she's got two stakes wins already, but Brian, she's only been sprinting and sprinting short.
Yeah. She's been going the 4.5, 5 furlong, 5.5 furlong route so far. And I wouldn't be at all surprised to see her on turf very soon. She could be a sprinter. She's got some breeding to stretch out. I wanted to put her on this list, Matt, because clearly she's one of the most talented two-year-old fillies in the country, and she's been awesome in her three starts. But I don't know if she'll stretch out. I don't know if she'll go to turf. I don't know if she'll end up in Royal Ascot next year. I don't even know if she'll end up in the Breeders' Cup Juvenile Fillies in a month. Probably not, but Averly Jane, one to watch down the road. One filly that I fully expect to be in the Breeders' Cup Juvenile Fillies is Electric Ride, Matt, another Daredevil filly. Daredevil has had his fillies of late. This one trained by John Sadler. She was the one that set the pace in the Chandelier, but Ain't Easy kind of took it over from her early on. But she did, to her credit, in her two-turn debut, only the second life race of her life after a nice main win, hold on clearly for second.
Yeah, and setting the pace for a progeny of Daredevil, that shouldn't be a big surprise. Interesting about this horse is that she's an Indiana bred, and John Sadler's got her based out in California, of course, sold for $250,000 as a 2-year-old. So an interesting prospect. And you mentioned Daredevil with the fillies. Of course, you were referring to that he has sired She Dares the Devil and Swiss Skydiver.
Yeah, that's right. Daredevil has some good fillies, and Electric Ride might be another one. Mm-hmm. I would expect her to move forward off of that second lifetime start where she set the pace and hung on for second. She also might be one who is out there on the pace. Maybe looking Echo Zulu in the eye early in this Breeders' Cup Juvenile Fillies. Good for the Indiana Breeders program, though, to see a nice, talented filly out of Indiana. A couple more I should mention, Matt. Grace Adler addled for much of the Chandelier. She was a heavy favorite in the Chandelier, and for good reason. The daughter, Curlin, had two big wins at Del Mar. The Del Mar debutante was no race at all, where she just inhaled them and won off for absolute fun. She was last for much of the way. I guess she passed a few horses, but for whatever reason, she didn't really fire at Santa Anita. Maybe she fires coming back to Del Mar for trainer Bob Baffert.
Yeah, maybe. And right, of course, it was Baffert, so well backed with that, with those past performances heading in. Throw in there that she was a high price purchase, a $700,000 purchase, but you know, she is a daughter of Curlin, so we would expect her to do better in longer races. We'll have to see what happens.
Yeah, it might be a case where we'll draw a line through that Chandelier, but she'll have some odds after the Chandelier flop. And I think, Matt, I think she's also your favorite character from Will and Grace. Is that true? Will and Grace, the sitcom. Yeah, never. You weren't a Will and Grace fan. Not one of your shows. All right. Grace Adler, good character from Will and Grace. Well, last filly on the list that I really want to mention, Matt, and I have a feeling she will not be in the Breeders' Cup Juvenile Fillies. But if she is, I'm interested. Classy Edition. I'm still hoping for good things for young sire Classic Empire, who I feel like never quite was able to fulfill his destiny on the racetrack for trainer Mark Cassie. This one is trained by Todd Pletcher, Matt, and she's been running against New York Breds, but I really like what I've seen. I don't think she's your average New York Bred.
No, that's for sure. And she was well-liked from the get-go, selling for a little more than $500,000. Nice speed figures, maiden special weight win, and then a New York Bred stakes win for Pletcher. Both of them very easily by open lengths.
Yeah, at Saratoga and then at Belmont. The stakes came at Belmont, where she stretched out a little bit. I think she is a filly with a big future. It'll be interesting to see if Pletcher adds this to his 2-year-old string to go out to Del Mar. Probably not. She hasn't faced opening company yet, but I think she is one to look out for. Matt, that's our first look at the Kentucky Derby and Kentucky Oaks horses of next year, which is always fun. But more immediate and more importantly for this show, they're the top contenders for the Breeders' Cup Juvenile. The Breeders' Cup Juvenile Fillies, also a mile and 16th, two turns, $2 million, Friday, November 5 at Del Mar. Folks, if you haven't yet subscribed to our YouTube channel here at Horse Racing Nation, I urge you to do so. Turn on those notifications, Matt, and I really appreciate it. Before we go, I do want to touch on what we saw on a big weekend last weekend, Matt. I think what we saw at Churchill Downs is what we expected in the Lucas Classic. I think it was easier than the what you can see on paper. It was fast, and I think it really pushes Nick's Go to become the favorite, going a mile and a quarter for the first time in his career in the Breeders' Cup Classic.
Yeah, it certainly looks that way. And Brad Cox got everything that he wanted out of the Lucas Classic. He wasn't looking to have Nick's go banging heads in a super tough race. He wanted one more race in there where he could do his thing, which is go two turns and get out in front and control and dominate the race. And right now, according to the Vegas betting the Vegas betting lines for the Classic, they have Nick's go as the favorite.
Yeah. And I don't expect anybody else to be the favorite. The second choice probably is his stablemate, Essential Quality, who will not run between the Travers and the Breeders' Cup Classic. But I think the Lucas Classic kind of put an end to the discussion who is the favorite, in my eyes, for the Breeders' Cup Classic. However, that same day, Speed was king, Matt, and on opposite coast in the Woodward and the Awesome Again, we saw some impressive wire chops, some front-running wire chops from horses who look like they're starting to peak and look like in Art Collector and Medina Spirit, a couple of horses who can make life very difficult for Nick's go at some point in the first mile of this Breeders' Cup Classic.
Yeah, Medina Spirit passed on the Pennsylvania Derby to stay home. I guess Baffert knew what he was doing, taking Medina Spirit to race against older horses for the first time. And he won that race easily and impressively, and seems to be in good form heading into the Classic and Art Collector out in New York in the Woodward. Came into the race with two wins since moving to the barn of Bill Mott. And he just kept on marching along, beating a pretty nice field, including Maxfield.
Yeah. Art Collector and Medina Spirit, you could say, had it their own ways. There was no real other speed in either of those races. But what they did was everything that their connections would want to see. They dominated. Like Nick's go, they looked strong in the stretch. It looked like they were still running as well as ever when they eventually had to turn it on early in the stretch or in mid-stretch. And, you know, Art Collector, Medina Spirit, maybe add Hot Rod Charlie to that list. They don't have what I would call Nick's go kind of speed, Matt, but I'm starting to wonder where the breather is going to be for Nick's go with horses peaking like Hot Rod Charlie, Art Collector, Medina Spirit, all of them with plenty of early speed. So it makes the Breeders' Cup Classic just a little bit more of a interesting betting race for me, if nothing else.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting to see, aside from those that top four that we mentioned, who else shows up in there and what the race dynamics are going to be.
Absolutely. Mile and a quarter with plenty of speed. That's a race I want to bet on, though, because I think maybe the favorite is vulnerable. Again, he's never been 10 furlongs. Nick's go. Matt, that's our Breeders' Cup two-year-old show, the juvenile fillies, looking ahead to the Oaks and the Derby next year. Good times, good stuff. Can I get a parting shot from you?
Yeah, hey, this begins our Breeders' Cup coverage. And of course, we've dabbled with some Breeders' Cup shows a few weeks or so ago, but we'll be talking Breeders' Cup as we head to the World Championships. And ultimately, we'll have our picks at pick shows the last couple weeks. And of course, I want to thank our producer, Ben Wilkie, for putting together the show.
Absolutely. Thanks to Ben. Thanks for all you watching every week. Yeah, as Matt alluded to, we are going to be Breeders' Cup centric. The World Championships at Del Mar just 4.5 weeks away here. So we're going to talk a lot of Breeders' Cup in all of these shows leading up to November 5 and November 6th at Del Mar. I also want to thank our sponsor, the best contest site out there. That's Derby Wars. Folks, we'll be back next week right here on Horse Center with another Breeders' Cup preview. We'll see you then.